إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم And the best guidance we have is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours, regardless of your sincerity or intention, regardless of any of that, everything that's newly invented into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ Every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدٍ My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we have a narration that we hear many of times, and it's one of the narrations that's it's an introduction to many of the books of knowledge, to many books of study. عن أمير المؤمنين أبو حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت حجرته إلى الله ورسوله فحجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت حجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو لامرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه رواه بخاري ومسلم عمر بن الخطاب the leader of the believers أبو حفص as he is named as well He said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, actions are judged by their intentions, by their niyyah. وَمَكَانَ النِّيَّةِ الْقَلْبِ And the place for the niyyah is the heart. It's not to be uttered with the lips, as many of the people do, with wudu, with salah, with hajj, with all these things. Actions are judged by their motives, by their niyyah, by their intention. So each man will have what he or she intended. Thus he whose migration, his hijrah, was to Allah and to his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then his migration is to Allah and his messenger. But he whose migration was for some worldly thing that he might gain in, or for a spouse, a wife that he might marry, then his migration is to that for which he migrated. As Muslims, we have to look at our intent behind everything we do. And we cannot fool, يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We might be able to fool the people. We might be able to even fool our own selves and delude our own selves. But we cannot fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we must look at the intent behind everything we do. Who is it for? What do we seek to gain by saying this or doing this? Who are we aiming to please? Whose pleasure are you seeking? The intent, the sincerity behind that intention is paramount to your deed being accepted. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن أول الناس يقضى يوم القيامة عليه رجل استشهد فأتي به فعرفه نعمه فعرفها قال فما عملت فيها قال قاتلت فيك حتى استشهدت قال كذبت ولكنك قاتلت لأن يقال جريء فقد قيل ثم أمر به فصحب على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار. On the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first of the people amongst who will be judged on the day of resurrection, whose judgment will be pronounced on the day of resurrection, will be a man who died as a shaheed, he died as a martyr. And he will be brought, and Allah will make known to him his favors that Allah gave him. And the man will recognize the favors of Allah. Then the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, what did you say? He will say, what did you do with these favors? He said, I fought for you until I died a shaheed, until I died a martyr. Allah will say, kadhabt. You have told a lie. You did but fight so that it might be said of you that this guy is courageous, bold, strong. And it was so said, and it was said to him, then he will be ordered, or then it will be said, he will be ordered to be dragged along his face until he's cast into the hellfire. According to the ulama, again, we should be cautious that the shaheed is known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many times we label this person a shaheed, a shaheed, a shaheed. Wallahu a'lam. Allah knows who the true shaheed is. The hadith continued about a person, as we had mentioned, the first of the people amongst whom the judgment will be pronounced on the day of resurrection. الثاني قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورجل تعلم العلم وعلمه وقرأ القرآن فأتي به فعرفه نعمه فعرفها قال فما عملت فيها قال تعلمت العلم وعلمته وقرأت فيك القرآن قال كذبت ولكنك تعلمت العلم ليقال عالم وقرأت القرآن ليقال قارئ فقد هو قارئ ليقال هو قارئ فقد قيل ثم أمر به فسحب على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار. So the second one, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned on the day of resurrection from the first people to be judged, and their announcement, their situation will be made known to the people, will be another man who studied the religious knowledge and taught the religious knowledge, and one who used to recite the Quran, the Book of Allah. He will be brought, and Allah will make known to him all of the favors Allah blessed him with. And the man will recognize those favors. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, and what did you do about them? He will say, I studied the ilm. I studied the religious knowledge and I taught it. I recited the Quran for your sake, for you. And Allah will say to this man, kadhabt. So the action without the niyyah being pure behind it means nothing. He will tell him, you have lied. You only studied religious knowledge so people would say you're an alim. You're a learned person, you're a scholar, and you recited the Quran, so it might be said, huwa qari', he's a reciter. And so it was said, then he will be ordered to be dragged along his face until he's cast into the hellfire. The niyyah behind everything we say and we do, my brothers and sisters in Islam, has to be purely for the sake of Allah. You can fool the people, you can fool yourself, you cannot fool the one above the seven heavens and the earth separate from his creation, who has knowledge of everything, وَهُوَ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ, and he's closer to you than your jugular vein. In terms of knowledge of everything going on, even in the innermost part of your body. So this man, he studied, he taught, he learned, he read the Book of Allah. But what was he doing it for? Who was he doing it for? And was it just to be called this and that by the people? Nowadays, you have these programs. If you come and study Islam here, 5 years, you'll be a sheikh. 7 years, you'll be an alim. 10 years, you'll be a mufti. And the ulama who've studied 40, 50 years, their blood, their sweat, establishing tawheed in the correct aqidah, and they refuse to call themselves sheikh. So be mindful of these tags, especially on, internet. that deceive the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ إِلَّا اللَّمَمْ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ وَاسِعٌ مَغْفِرَةٌ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِكُمْ إِذْ أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَإِذْ أَنْتُمْ أَجِنَّةٌ فِي بَطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنْفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, what means those who avoid the great deeds, those who avoid the great sins, and the fahisha, the illegal intimacy that you shouldn't do, except with whom you are legally married to, except with small faults. Verily your Lord is vast of forgiveness. He knows you well. When He created you from the earth, Adam alayhi salam, and when you were fetuses in the wombs of your mothers, so ascribe not purity to yourselves. Allah knows best who fears Allah and keeps His duty to Him, who has taqwa. Do the good to please your Lord, but never think you've done enough. Do the good to please Allah, but always call into question your intention being pure, your sincerity being pure for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah knows best who has taqwa. إِنَّ أَكْرَمُكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The one who's best in the sight of Allah is the one who has that taqwa, fears Allah, is conscious of Allah, keeps his duty to Allah, lives in obedience to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so as if to put a barrier between him himself and the punishment of Allah. The last one that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned in this hadith, from the first to be judged on the Day of Judgment, and their judgment will be made known to the people. قال ورجل وسع الله عليه وعطاه من أصناف المال كله فأتي به فعرفه نعمه فعرفها قال فما عملت فيها قال ما تركت من سبيل تحب أن ينفق فيها إلا أنفقت فيها لك قال كذبت ولكنك فعلت ليقال هو جواد فقد قيل ثم أمر فيه فسحب على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار رواه مسلم وكذلك في الترمذي وفي النسائي. Another man that is mentioned as the final of these three who will be judged first on the Day of Resurrection will be a man who Allah made rich, and this richness is not يعني in palaces and this and that. Brothers, please, every Jum'ah. There is noise, there is talking, there is looking at forms, there is salam to one another. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَسْجِدُ وَالْإِمَامُ يَخْطُبُ فَلْيَرْكَعْ رَكْعَتَيْنِ وَلْيَتَجَوَّزْ فِيهِمَا. He said, whoever comes to the masjid when the imam is giving the khutbah, he should pray two rak'ahs and then sit and make them light. وَقَالَ مَنْ مَسَّ الْحَفَ فَقَدْ لَغَى وَمَنْ لَغَى فَلَا جُمْعَةَ لَهُ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, whoever even plays with the carpet in front of him, a stone, because they didn't have carpets like we have. They didn't have this comfort that we have. Whoever even plays with that stone, whoever gives salams to his brother, even shaking his hand, whoever responds to him, whoever tells him, ansut, or be quiet, فَقَدْ لَغَى. He has committed idle talk, فَلَا جُمْعَةَ لَهُ. Then he has no jum'ah, or maybe his jum'ah reward is decreased. When you come through those doors, leave the dunya behind you as much as you can. You can give salam to your brother or sister for the sisters after Jum'ah. You can talk after Jum'ah. If there's some little talk, some of the elderly brothers, maybe they can't hear as well. They talk, they think they're low, they're quiet, but they're loud, or we need to give them a prayer rug. Excuse this, inshallah we have a different time now. But some of this is nonsense. To look at your phone, to whisper, to come during the khutbah. It's not me. I need no respect from you. We're talking about respecting the deen of Allah. When you come into the masjid, zip it. Don't talk to no one. Even if he puts his hand out, don't put your hand back out. You will get rewarded. And after the salah, after the khutbah, you can give him salams and say, sorry, I didn't do it because I didn't want to ruin my jum'ah. And teach him. So this other man, he came, who was made rich, or to have money by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was given all kinds of wealth. He will be brought, and Allah will make known to him his favors, and he will recognize those favors. Allah will say to him, what did you do with the favors I bestowed you with, the blessings I gave you? He will say, I left no path untrodden in which you like money to be spent, but I spent money in your cause. For your sake, he will say, كذبت, you have told a lie. You did so that it might be said of you, you're open-handed, you're generous, you're kind, you're giving. This is the reason. And so it will be said, then he will be ordered to be dragged along his face. Afwan. That's what was said about him. And so it will be ordered by Allah that this person be dragged along his face until he's cast into the hellfire. And this hadith is in Muslim and also in the Sunan of Tirmidhi and Nisa'i, and it is an authentic hadith. The intention with this last one, a common disease in our hearts, giving to say I gave, giving so that others pray you, giving because others gave, giving even though you hate to give, that it annoys you. My brothers and sisters in Islam, look very closely that what you do, what you give is only for your own soul. You're not doing me or nobody else a favor. You're not doing Allah a favor. He owns everything. بِاللَّهِ مِرَاثِ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He owns the mirath of the heavens and the earth. Everything belongs to Allah. Every single bit of it. What you give is only for your own soul. Allah doesn't need it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ فِي بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى كَالَّذِي يُنْفِقُ مَالَهُ رِئَاءَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فمثله كمثل صفوان عليه تراب فأصابه وابل فتركه صلدا لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا والله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. Allah says in Surah Al-Baqarah, what means, O you who believe, do not render in vain your sadaqah. Do not render in vain, do not spoil the charity you give by reminders of your generosity or by injury. Like him who spends his wealth to be seen of men. Although he doesn't believe in Allah, nor in the last day, his likeness is the likeness of a smooth rock that has a little dust on it. On it falls a heavy rain, and then it leaves the rock bare, as if there was nothing upon it. They are not able to do anything with what they have earned, and Allah does not guide the disbelieving people. Never remind of the favors you do. Your intention, sincerity should always be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know when it comes to Ramadan, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه ومن قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه رواه البخاري. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in authentic hadith, whoever fasted the month of Ramadan out of sincere faith, true belief, intending to please Allah, hoping for the reward from Allah, then all of his past sins will be forgiven from the minor sins. Wallahu a'lam. And whoever stood the prayers in the night of Laylatul Qadr out of sincere faith, hoping for the reward from Allah, intending to please Allah only and not to have one person even know that they are reaching out to Allah, then all of his previous sins from the minor sins will be forgiven. And this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما قال عبد لا إله إلا الله قط مخلصا إلا فتحت له أبواب السماء حتى تفضي إلى العرش ما اجتنب الكبائر رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, no worshipper has ever said لا إله إلا الله, that there is none that has the right to be worshipped except for Allah alone without partners. مخلصاً, sincerely, that intent of him saying that is sincerity to worship Allah, full belief, the yaqeen, the certainty that Allah is the only one who is the creator of the heavens and the earth, the only one that should be worshipped, the only one whose names and his attributes belong completely to him. Whoever says it sincerely, there is nothing for them except that the gates of Jannah will be opened for it. Until it reaches to the throne, so long as he avoids the major sins, the kaba'ir. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, our intention, our sincerity, is principle for our deeds being accepted. That and ittiba' the sunnah of Nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the intention and sincerity of that intention being clean are the two things you need for that deed to be accepted. So although the action may be good, If the intention or the sincerity is just to please others, Allah will give you the pleasure of others. But you won't have His pleasure. Purify your intentions. And I advise myself first. Make them sincere for our Creator who's given us so much that we could never repay Him. We can't even count all of His blessings. And if you were to count the blessings of Allah, you'd never be able to enumerate them. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم الله يغفر لكم ذنوبكم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد We began the khutbah with the hadith that many of us know from Amir al-Mu'mineen, Abu Hafs, Amr ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, أنه قال, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. To the end of the hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, indeed your actions are judged by their intentions, and every person will have what he or she intended. Our intentions, the sincerity behind them has to be purely for Allah. If you can't get it any way to please Allah or to purely worship Him sincerely with pure intent, except that if you do certain things without anybody being around, then do it that way. We need to purify our intentions or our deeds, no matter how many or good they are, they're worth nothing. Just like a rock, as was mentioned, that a heavy rain fell on and wiped it clean. Nothing is left on it. Nothing will be left for us to have good deeds, to weigh on our scales if we wipe them away with the ill intention or the intention or the motive being to please somebody or something else. An Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhu, قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نظر الله امرأ سمع مقالتي فبلغها فرب حامل فقه غير فقيه ورب حامل فقه إلى من هو أفقه منه زاد فيه علي بن محمد ثلاث لا يغل عليهن قلب امرئ مسلم إخلاص العمل لله والنصح لأئمة المسلمين ولزوم جماعتهم This hadith, which is graded as Hasan, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, may Allah cause his face to shine. The man who hears what I convey, and he conveys it to others. May Allah cause his face to shine. A dua from the Prophet ﷺ, that whoever relates his authentic hadith, not this da'if stuff, not this made up stuff, not this, when you see those, get them out of your system. So many of them are quoted, and they're not to be referenced because of their weakness or their fabrication. May Allah cause His face to shine. The man who hears what I say and conveys it to others. There are those who have knowledge, but they got no understanding. You can know the books back and forth, forth and back, up, down, whatever way you want to know it. But you don't have the understanding of that, then you're void of your knowledge is really empty. It's just like an empty canister. And there are maybe those who convey knowledge to those who have more understanding of it than they do. And you may give knowledge out and someone may understand it even better than the one giving the knowledge himself. One of the narrators, Ali ibn Muhammad, he added to it, there are three things because of which hatred does not enter the heart of a Muslim. Three things that if you have them, hatred will not enter the heart of the Muslim. He said, sincerity in doing an action for Allah. When you're sincere in your intention to only please Allah, to only have Allah be pleased with you, even if the people are disappointed with you. But you know you stuck to what is correct and you stuck to the haq. If your purity and your intention is to follow the Quran and the Sunnah, regardless of what the people may say or how they may mock you or make fun of you or whatever it may be, this gets you a heart free of hatred. When you are sincere towards the rulers of the Muslims, as we've said in many a hadith, even if they beat you, even if they steal your wealth, Unless they command you to do to a haram, you're supposed to listen, sam'a wa ta'a, listen and obey. The one who has this sincerity towards the leader of the Muslims makes dua for him when he sees his faults. This person is closer to having no hatred in their heart. And adhering to the jama'ah. Adhering to the jama'ah. And this doesn't necessarily mean the main body of the Muslims, okay, we say Sunni. Because even within those who claim to be Sunni, is a lot of deviation in tawheed and aqeedah. And we have to call it for what it is. And our Prophet ﷺ said that when he said that we'd be divided into 73 different sects. كُلُّهُمْ فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدًا. All of them in the fire except for one. قَالُوا مَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. They were asked, the Prophet ﷺ was asked, who is that group? He said, مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِمْ يَوْمَ أَصْحَابِي. What I am upon today, 1400 plus years ago, and my companions. Not some made-up version of Islam that we think we have to adapt because we're in 2021. When we adhere to the jama'ah, this is those who are upon the Quran and the Sunnah. And you know you do that for the face of Allah, to seek the face of Allah, the pleasure of Allah, then you have done what you need to do so that hatred does not enter your heart. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ لَنْ يُدْخِلَ أَحَدَكُمْ عمل عفوا قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سددوا وقاربوا واعملوا واعلموا ان لن يدخل احدكم عمله الجنه وان احب الاعمال ادومها الى الله وان قل. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said an authentic hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, narrated from Aisha, the mother of the believers رضي الله عنها, may Allah be pleased with her. Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, do good deeds properly, do them the right way, properly, sincerely, your intention only being that the creator of the heavens and the earth is the only one who you want to, yani, be happy with you and pleased with you, to grant you his forgiveness and his mercy, and do them moderately, and know that your deeds, they are not going to be what gets you into Jannah. Your deeds will not make you enter paradise. It is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the most beloved deed to Allah is the most regular and constant one, even if it's little. So do good deeds, even if they're little. Never belittle the little deed. Do it properly, sincerely, intending to please Allah only. Do it moderately. Don't go to extremes in the religion. And know that your deeds will never make you enter paradise. The most beloved deeds to Allah are the regular ones and constant, even if they're small. May Allah make us of those who purify their intentions and their... do all of what we do,
Ameen.
Sincerely seeking the pleasure of our Creator, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ameen. So that He grants us that mercy we need to enter His Jannah. Allahumma khfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka antas sami'un qareeb al mujib al da'wat ya muqallib al qulub thabbit quluban ala deenik subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.